God, that your Holy Spirit would lead us into all truth in this very divisive, sometimes divisive area of Scripture. Lord, your Holy Spirit brings unity to the body of Christ, not division. And so, Lord, I pray that you'd bring unity to us tonight as we study your word. In Jesus' name, amen, 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 amen. Awesome. So, hey, everyone good?
Everyone good? Good to see everyone.
So I want you to do me a favor. I want you to open up your Bibles to Acts chapter 2. I do want to say, as you're turning there, how awesome it is that Jerome and Amara brought their baby home. Yeah, that's so awesome. The baby that was not supposed to live, you know, come say goodbye to your baby is the phone call they got. And so that baby is now home, completely healthy. And every single time they say something could be wrong, I'm just going to say God proves them wrong, and she's just perfect. And so I'm just grateful for that. He is good, and she's beautiful, man. Like, she's beautiful, and not as pretty as my kids, but, you know, I'm just saying. Love you guys if you're watching. But, hey, Acts chapter 2, we're going to continue to venture into this 28 chapters of total crazy, amazing stuff. And so here's the way it works. It's to the ends of the earth, right? That's what God wants. He wants his stuff to go to the ends of the earth. And so here's how it works. So it says in 2 Timothy 2:22, Paul says to Timothy, listen, you've heard me teach these truths. And so what I want you to do is I want you to take these truths that I'm teaching you and share them with trustworthy men and women who will in turn tell others. That's how the kingdom gets to the ends of the earth. So we're all involved with that. Listen to that. That's like three generations, if you will, three steps. You've heard me teach. Now go teach others who will in turn teach others. So what are we doing? This is how we make disciples. You make disciples who make disciples who make disciples who make disciples. And Lord willing, the chain never breaks. And that's how the gospel gets to the ends of the earth. And when it means the ends of the earth, since the earth, I think, is round. Y'all can flat earth all you want. I think it's round. It's not the ends of the earth because there's no end to a circle, but it means to the last person. It gets to every single person. And that's how this is supposed to work. And so that's what we want to do with this message series right here. So first two sermons, we talked about how Jesus was, he appeared to his disciples and he says, listen, I want you to go to Jerusalem and hang out right there. And that gift that you got, that was promised, this Holy Spirit's going to come and he's going to empower you from upon high and you're going to be my witnesses, right, to the ends of the earth. That means somehow or another this message is going to get to you, right, and the Holy Spirit's going to empower you and through your faithful witness, everyone on earth is going to find out about Jesus. And somehow made it here to Leesburg. That's pretty remarkable. And so they go to Jerusalem. And you see in chapter 1, verse 14 of the book of Acts, it says, what's it say there? Oh, they all met together and were constantly united in prayer. So last week we jumped to brick 2, which is what? They were constantly united in prayer. That's what they did. That before you talk to God about something, right? We learn that you have to be united first in thought. We all think the same. We all think that Jesus is Lord, that Jesus is right, that the Word of God is true and it should be obeyed. And then we unite in our purpose. Like, why are we breathing? To get the gospel out. That's why. That's why he saved you, so you can get the gospel out, right? And so we're all united in purpose. And then knowing what we all think alike and that we all are on the same purpose and mission, that's what we talk to God about. And that's what they did. And so that was brick 2. But now we're going backwards to brick 1. And I said we would hold off on brick 1 because that's what tonight's all about. And listen, I don't know if this is going to be a... I don't know... Some people are a lot smarter than me, and they know the difference between preaching and teaching. I haven't figured that one out yet. Because I think that when you preach, you should teach, and when you teach, you should preach. And so I think that either way, what you're doing is you're heralding a message that's not yours. It's not mine. I didn't write this book. I'm not Jesus. I'm just an unworthy servant doing my duty, right? And so I just want to, like, if I was going to differentiate between preaching and teaching, I would say that maybe tonight is... Maybe more teaching, because I've never experienced what we're going to talk about tonight. But I'm just going to tell you what it says in the Bible, and then you have a choice to make with it. So you got to do with it what you do, and I'll let the Holy Spirit do with it what he wants to do. And my job is just to herald. This is what it says. And so that's what I want to do. But brick one is the beginning of that verse, verse 14, which is, they all met together. And I think this is critical for powerful, effective ministry that accomplishes the mission that Jesus Christ has Revolution Church on. He planted it for a reason. And I think that's what this is all about. Now, I've mentioned, if you've been coming to this church for any length of time, you've probably heard me say this lots of times, that we don't want to like grab one little verse out of the Bible and form a whole doctrine or a whole theology based on one verse. Like, I understand there's some verses that stand alone and there's no other verse like them, and we could stand on that thing like, Jesus Christ is the way. Okay, so we don't have to wonder, hey, I wonder if maybe there's just like some obscure little verse in there that teaches something opposite. No, Jesus said, I'm the way. No one gets to the Father except through me. I get all that. But generally speaking, we don't want to just grab one verse and form a whole church on it, right? We want to look and see if maybe there's multiple verses in the Bible that teach the same thing. So, in other words, this. I understand that the verse would teach this. But we can kind of screw that up if it's only one. We could. I know I can. I know you can. So the question is this. Does the Bible teach this? That's what we're looking for. We want to know if the Bible teaches something as a whole, okay? And so Acts 1:14 alone stands powerfully as a prescriptive text. In other words, it explains to us in a descriptive way, like, hey, guys, this is the way you should do it. You should all meet together. Like, I want to do something powerful when you all meet together. And so that stands alone. It teaches us by example of what we should do. However, if you read the book of Acts, you're going to see that by the end of just, now there's 28 chapters, by the end of chapter 5, so just like this much scripture, by the end of chapter 5, there's four more areas within that short section of scripture that teach the same thing. And so I think, and maybe I'm wrong, but I think that when something is repeated so often, and then listen, on top of so often in a concentrated context. And in this context, we're talking about the church being birthed, right? Just in these first few chapters of the book of Acts, when the church is being birthed, you see something repeated four times in five chapters. And when I see that, I don't know about you, but I think that God's trying to make a point. He doesn't need to repeat himself unless he feels it's necessary that the kids aren't listening, parents, right? Right? If you've got kids, right, wouldn't it be awesome? Sweetheart, just clean your room. Oh, sure, no problem. And then they do it perfectly. How many times has that ever happened? Never, right? So when a dad repeats himself, it's not that dad is dumb or forgetful. It's because the kids don't listen. So you see, he's got concentrated teaching here. I want you to write down. You got your notebooks open, don't you? I want you to write down a couple of sections of scripture. And I thought we'd get to them all in 1 week. We're not going to get to it even close. We're going to get to the first one this week. But I want you to write these things down. Let's see if, I don't think I've listed them there, did I? Acts 2. 1 through 12, so jot that down. Oh, they're all there. Nice. Okay, you see them up there on the screen. Jot those down, because I want you to, I'd like for you this week, a little homework in church, I'd like for you to just read these. Like, you don't have to, I'm not going to be a test on it or anything like that. You don't have to take notes, although you should, but you should read these sections of Scripture, because it talks about all meeting together, and what you're going to see when God's people meet together, God does some crazy powerful stuff. And I think we all desperately want to see that. Like, we want the building to quake, right? Like, we look at Pentecost, like, and the building's shaking and the wind comes through. Like, that'd be awesome, right? That'd be awesome. We'd love to see the Red Sea open. We'd like to see all these healings. We'd like to see all this stuff, right? We want to see, like, the Bible God come alive again. Open up the ancient gates and let the King of Glory come. We want to see it. And what he says here is, like, when you guys all come together, you're going to see me do some crazy stuff. So you see him there on the board, on the screen, jot those things down. And let me say this, though, before we jump into any of that, we're only going to study the first one tonight. But before we jump into any of that, I want you to understand, like, the context here, like, what's going on. This birth of the church, okay, it's not like now in this. All of it takes place right there, like, in Jerusalem, okay? It's all right there in this one city. Now, I don't know about you, but I thought Jerusalem was kind of big. I've never been there. Some of you may have been there. Maybe you've studied a little bit about it. But I was completely way off on the size of Jerusalem and how all that works. So you see, in all these sections, you're going to see them. They all meet together. And so the church is in its infancy. So when all the people lived together, they met together, it seems like, wow, that was amazing they all did this. But listen, they all lived in Jerusalem. Do you know how big? I thought Jerusalem was big. Maybe it's just because it's in the news all the time. That makes my mind think it's big. Do you know how big it is? Square miles? 48. 48 square miles. Okay, I want to give you some perspective. Leesburg's 42. Jerusalem's the same size as Leesburg. This little nothing, little town right here, right? That's how big Jerusalem is. Orlando, and that's like I think it's the 73rd largest city in the Union. It's almost 114 square miles. So just think of how little Jerusalem is. So now does it make a little more sense that they all met together, right? They live next door to each other. And not only that, listen, 48 square miles is only the size of Leesburg, just a little bit more. But you know, if you go there, just like you go here, there's certain areas of our city that are more populated than others. You can live out in the sticks of Leesburg. There's still some sticks. Not as much anymore. It's growing. It's becoming more populated. But you know, you got to understand, like, so there's the temple there, right? And most of the people, they lived right around that area. So when they met together, it was a little bit different than it is now. Now, there's believers spread across the whole earth. They didn't just concentrate in this 48 square mile, itty bitty little Leesburg sized city. So please understand that this is not about geography. When it says they all met together, it's not about geography. It's not like everyone has to go to Israel. It's not like, you know, like the Muslim got to go to Mecca to worship thing. It's not like that in any way. As a matter of fact, Jesus actually talks a little bit about that because people get confused about that. Like, there's a place you have to go. And he confronts that in John chapter 4 with this lady, and she says, hey, listen, why do my people worship God on Mount Gerizim, and these other people, these Jewish people, they worship him over here? And he says, listen, the time's coming, it's already here, that the Father don't care where it is. Like, geography means nothing. It started in Jerusalem, but there's going to be a day that's not going to matter anymore. It starts there, but now I want it to grow. So I want it to be on every mountaintop and in every valley, in every town, in every city. That's where I want this. And so all this together stuff, it's not a Jerusalem thing at all. And as a matter of fact, the Apostle Paul really teaches us what this means by his actions. What started out there in Israel, in Jerusalem and all, now Paul gets the gospel. And he didn't stick around there in Jerusalem with his whole ministry. What did he do? He went around to all that Middle East area, all around the Mediterranean, up into what we would call Turkey, you know, Asia Minor, and Rome and Greece and all the islands in the Mediterranean. He went to all those places and he began to preach the gospel. And people began to receive it and believe it. And they'd gather around him and they began to worship Jesus Christ and him crucified. And what happens when people come around? He says, listen, I'm going to disciple you. Just like he said to Timothy, you've heard me preach these things. Now go share this stuff with other trustworthy people who will in turn teach others. And so what he does is he disciples and preaches and teaches over some time. And those that really receive it well and mature in the faith, he appoints them as elders to oversee that church. And what does Paul do? He packs his stuff and he's on to the next city to replicate his efforts, spreading it ever so closer to the ends of the earth. And so now, because of what Paul and other guys like him have done, there's disciples of Jesus Christ all over the world, including right here in this room tonight, and that blows my brains. Acts 17:27 says that God's purpose, what he's doing, what he wants, what he's doing right now, his desire is that all nations, understand that's not the border of the United States of America. This is dirt. Nations represent the people that live in the nation, right? So he says, my purpose, God's purpose is that all nations, i.e. all people, would seek God, would, listen, this is kind of a weird word, feel their way toward him. It's almost like they don't know what they're doing, but somehow, some way, they're getting drawn in by this Holy Spirit that's just drawn them to God, right? His purpose is that they would seek God, they would feel their way toward him, and ultimately, it says, they would find him. Now, you couple that truth with what God desires with this, Ephesians 4:16, that God places us together perfectly. When you couple those two truths together, and what we see is this Jesus Christ building his church as promised back in Matthew 16:18 by saving people all over the world through the faithful witness of those who already know him, and then drawing them together. Once they're saved, he draws them together into local expressions all over the world, local expressions, local groups, local what? Churches. Just like we're in right here, right now. So, I want to skim through these four sections that I had you jot down. I want to do that and go over all of these all meet together sections, and let's find out what's going on here when they meet together and what God does in response to their obedience to meet together. And so I hope you've turned your attention to Acts chapter 2, verses 1 through 12. It's probably the most famous of all the all met together texts in Scripture, okay? So I'm going to read it with you, or for you, and you can read along in whatever version you have. Are you guys ready to hear it, to read it? All right, 3, 2, 1. On the day of Pentecost, all the believers were we're all meeting together in one place. Suddenly there was a sound from heaven like the roaring of a mighty windstorm, and it filled the house where they were sitting. Then what looked like flames or tongues of fire appeared and settled on each of them, and everyone present was filled with the Holy Spirit and began speaking in, depending on your translation, in tongues or other languages. We're just going to call it tongues anytime we see it. The reason why it says other languages in this Bible, this New Living, is because the New Living is a thought-for-thought translation. It's trying to give you the idea behind what is tongues, in other words, so that you understand, oh, it's another language. Okay, I get it. And it's unknown. So it's tongues. So they start speaking in tongues as the Holy Spirit gave them this ability. At that time, there were devout Jews from every nation living in Jerusalem. When they heard the loud noise, everyone came running, and they were bewildered to hear their own languages being spoken by the believers. They were completely amazed. I would be too, right? You walk in a room, that's happening. What? Right? You know God's doing something, right? So yeah, they were completely amazed. How can this be? They exclaimed. These people are all from Galilee. So Galilee is just that little area above Jerusalem where that itty-bitty little lake is. It's bigger than Lake Dora, but it's not massive like the Mediterranean Sea. It's just a lake. And these followers are just from these little towns all around that, right? And these people know that. Like, these people are from Galilee. Like, how can this be happening? Yet we hear them speaking in our own native language. So they come from all these different places, and these regular guys that are not like super educated, Harvard graduate, bilingual, they're fishermen. And all of a sudden they're speaking not just, wow, they all figured out Spanish. That's like a Rosetta Stone. That's awesome. Must have been a class. No, they're speaking every language. Freaky, right? Freaky. These people are all from Galilee, yet we hear them speaking in our own native language. And so here's this list. So it's not just like one or two different kinds of people, but it's Parthians, Medes, Elamites, people from Mesopotamia, Judea, Cappadocia, Pontus, the province of Asia, Phrygia, Pamphylia, Egypt, areas of Libya, Cyrene, visitors from Rome, and they were Jews and converts to Judaism. So there was Gentiles who didn't speak Hebrew, it was something else, Cretans, Arabs, like all just mixed bag of people with all different languages. They're all there. Listen, you know why they're there? To celebrate a holiday. So they did go to Jerusalem then to celebrate a holiday. We're going to see that in a second, but that's why they're there. That's why they were living there for the high holidays. And we're all here, these people speaking in our own languages. What were they speaking about? The wonderful things God has done. They stood there amazed and perplexed. What can this mean, they asked. I left out verse 13 because it can just be silly, but some people were thinking they were drunk because they were just speaking, which doesn't make any sense to me. Like, if you're, I hate to say it, I've been drunk lots of times. And when I'm drunk, I don't get smarter. Anyone? Okay. Kind of a foolish accusation. Okay, so here's what we see happening in this text. We see the fulfillment. This is how amazing Jesus is. And just let me just say this. Like, if you're not Christian, then you probably think that this dude Jesus, you know, like he got killed by Rome. Like, he's a guy who gets killed. So he's like, we all know that he's alive, right? It's a great place for an amen. You know he's alive, right? Okay. So yes, thank you. So, but to the lost world, like, so there's this dead guy, right? So this dead guy says, I'm going to build my church. And this dead guy says he's going to send this spirit. So that's totally crazy, right? And he's going to empower you to do this stuff. So the dead guy disappears. And all of a sudden, this happens. Right? He can't manipulate a situation. He's not behind the building with a fan, you know, blowing it in, going, like, he's not doing anything. He's dead. He's dead, right? Gone. He's not. But you know what I'm saying, right? Can't manipulate anything. But yet, we see the fulfillment of Acts chapter 1:4, where he says, hey, if you go there, the Holy Spirit's going to come upon you. You're going to be powered from upon high. And we see it happening right here, right? And what else we see happening after the gift of the Holy Spirit comes, we see the beginning, at least, of the fulfillment of Acts 1:8, where it says, hi, Greg. It doesn't say hi, Greg. But it says that when you get empowered from upon high, you're going to be my witnesses to the ends of the earth. And we see that now actually happening right here. Everything he said would happen, even though he's quote unquote, you see the quotes, he's dead, it's happening. Supernatural stuff going on in this room. And it's freaking out not just the Jewish people, but all the people from all over. The people that are not part of the team are watching this go, what is going on here? It's amazing. So listen, I said I wanted to teach. So let's just talk about Pentecost for a second, because I don't know about you, but when I became a Christian, Pentecost became the time that this happened. And that's not what it is. That's not what Pentecost is. This stuff, this crazy stuff happened while they were celebrating Pentecost. So I think that obedience to God's word is super important here, because like as Karen was saying earlier, we got these holidays we're supposed to obey and keep. And so if they blew off Pentecost, this wasn't going to happen. It happened when they were celebrating Pentecost, right? He said, I want you to celebrate these holidays, and if you do, like, look what happens. So obedience is definitely the funnel where blessing flows, right? So let's just talk a little bit about Pentecost. And the reason why I want to do this is, like, when we did Passover, everyone's like, let's talk about Passover. It's Jesus, the Lamb, the Lamb. Like, I get all that. Like, it's a foreshadowing of the Lamb and the blood on the door, and then there's the blood of the Lamb, and he's a sacrifice. All that, I get it. Okay, but that's not Passover. Passover is when the Jews got out of Egypt and went to Israel, and the angel of death passed over, and we're supposed to celebrate that. It is a foreshadow of Jesus. I get that. But let's not negate the actual holiday that God said to celebrate. So I want to talk about Pentecost just because I think more informed Christians are better worshipers. He says to worship him in spirit. So we get fired up, awesome, but based on what? Truth, okay? So just here's what Pentecost is, because I just never really knew this. So Pentecost is a Greek word, and it's the name of the Hebrew holiday called Shavuot. Shavuot, you don't have to spell it, it doesn't matter. Shavuot, Hebrew. In English, we'd call it the Feast of Weeks, like 7 weeks, and that's really what it was. It was 7 weeks and a day after Passover. That's when God said, do it then. So it's 50 days after Passover. Now, back then, if it was possible, you would travel to Jerusalem to get together with all of the people. And that's why you see all of them coming from all these different places. But as we saw earlier from in the Gospel of John, chapter 4, Jesus said, listen, it doesn't matter. You don't have to come to Jerusalem to celebrate Pentecost. But listen, if you're close, if you can, jump on a camel, come on over. You can. And so you see people doing that. I don't know why I say stuff like that. It just comes out. It just comes out. I don't think that's Holy Spirit driven either. I think it's completely me. Shavuot was a... Nobody wants to talk about this. It's a first fruits celebration. First fruits, meaning like every week when you get together, corporate worship, you bring your offering to the Lord, you bless the Lord with the offering, you use it to keep all the stuff going in the temple and in the church, and you provide for the Levites, and you provide for reaching out to the world with the gospel. I get all that. You're showing thanksgiving. You're showing generosity. You're partnering with Jesus. I get all that offering stuff. We all should do it. That's fine. But first fruits is, listen, above and beyond my weekly thing that I do, Lord, I'm coming to you with praise and thanksgiving and just saying, God, you are such an incredible provider, and I want to give you the first and biggest and best offering of my year. Thank you, God, for all that you do for me. And that's what they would do. They would bring their first fruits offering to the temple. That's what they did. Shavuot, or Pentecost as we call it all the time, was celebrated at the conclusion of the wheat harvest. It was an agricultural society, not like here now. We're agriculture because we go to Walmart and go to the produce section. Okay, but they didn't have that. All right, so you had farms and stuff, and they said there was an agricultural society, and so the wheat harvest, that was a big deal. Like, that's, to us... We're so spoiled. I'm so spoiled. Are you spoiled? I'm so spoiled, right? They were just so thankful they had food. You know what I mean? Like, thank you, God, you caused it to rain. Thank you. Like, we're like, man, it hasn't rained in like 2.5 weeks. Like, my lawn's getting brown. They're like, if you don't rain, God, we don't have irrigation systems like we do now. Like, if it doesn't rain, we die. Right, so like they're super grateful for stuff we take for granted. And so they were super grateful about the wheat harvest. And so that's why that's what they celebrated at Pentecost. They weren't celebrating tongues and fire coming down out of the ceiling. They were celebrating that, the goodness and provision of God so we could eat. And tradition, in the Hebrew tradition, although it's not in Scripture, but the Hebrew tradition, they also, part of that celebration is that they believe that it was during that time of the year where they would celebrate this, it was during that season of the annual calendar that God showed up on Sinai to provide the law to Israel through Moses. So it's a big deal. Again, not in the Bible that way. Not to say that it isn't that time. Kind of like what we do. We celebrate Jesus' birth at Christmas. Yeah, that probably didn't happen then. But it's still a good day to celebrate him. We could celebrate him any day. Let's celebrate him today. Thank you, Jesus, for coming. Like, that's awesome. But so they're just going to say, listen, I think it was kind of during that time, so let's just throw that in there too, because it is a super festive kind of time, and so that's what they would celebrate. It's one of the three feasts, like Karen said, it's one of the three feasts / festivals that is commanded by God in Exodus 34 to be observed by his people, listen, every year, forever. So I repent that we didn't do Pentecost this year. And I'm going to make a commitment to you. That's not happening ever again. We boo-booed. So we'll take heat. Take some heat with me. At least if you could take half of it, I'd feel better, right? That'd be make me better. Thanks. I'm glad you're here tonight. My bad. So listen. Now, for the charismatic people that might be in the room, like, just chill for a second. We're going to talk about tongues. But just wait. Just wait, okay? It's coming. But listen, the real reason that we're going to study this, the real reason it's in here, it's all part of that meta-narrative of the book of Acts, which is to spread the gospel of Jesus Christ to the ends of the earth. Acts chapter 2, Pentecost, it's not about tongues. It's about tongues and what happened there, but it's for a greater reason than just tongues. Tongues doesn't end on itself. It rolls up to something greater. Something greater is that God would use this thing, as you saw right there in the story. He was using it to spread the kingdom of God, this kingdom of Christ, this thing called his church, to the ends of the earth. So what you see there is this remarkable thing that God He's orchestrated this crazy situation where everyone is coming, right? They're all coming. He said, go to Jerusalem. I'm going to send the Holy Spirit. You're going to be witnesses to the ends of the earth. Now, how would these people, just this little group of people, ever think, man, how could we reach the whole world? I mean, don't you think that here tonight, really? Let's just be honest. How can this group of 25 people here, how could we reach the world? Like, God, we need your help with that, right? Look what's... So you imagine, right? The church hasn't even happened yet. This is a fresh new thing. They've never seen any evidence that it could spread, it could work. They don't know. I want you to be my witness to the ends of the earth. Like, way out there? So what's God orchestrating? He's got people from way out there coming right here to listen to the wonderful things that Jesus has done. So they're all making this massive pilgrimage to Jerusalem. Hey, there's more than one way to skin a cat, right? There's more than one way. And see, we're constantly in the church, especially here in America, it's the only context I know. We're always in this outreach mode. That's what everybody talks about. People come in here all the time. What's your outreach? What outreach do you have? You gotta be reaching out. I get it. I'm not saying that we shouldn't. But sometimes reaching out isn't what we think. God is doing something totally different right here. We're told to reach out. But God is bringing people to us to hear the good news of Jesus Christ. And just like those folks right there in the upper room, perhaps we need to just stop looking for and planning the next big outreach program, next big outreach with the feeding and the concerts and multi-church, get it out there where everybody can see it. But instead, perhaps you and I just need to open up our eyes and see who God's actually already brought into your life. And then just open your mouth like they did and let God speak. John 4:34-35 says, isn't it, you say it's 4 months until the harvest. But I say, Jesus says, wake up and look around you that the fields are already ready for the harvest. See, we're always looking for that next big best thing to reach our city. We got to organize something. Let's throw a bunch of money at it. Let's get all those pastors in town. Let's all get them on board to do this next big thing. Should we do that? Maybe. But he's already got you around a bunch of people. Right? The harvest is right there. He's like, listen, wake up, man. Lift up your eyes. Look around you. Look at the other waitresses and waiters at work, your cooks. Look at the people at your restaurant. How about the people that work where you are at Publix? How about at Waffle House? Anywhere, wherever you are. Aren't there people there that need to hear the gospel? And they're just waiting for you to open your mouth so they could be saved. And it's, listen, he says, isn't the harvest 4 months? A lot of people, we talked about this on Wednesday, a lot of people are like, well, listen, I'm going to share, I just started working at a restaurant, and there's this nice waitress, her name's Dina. And so I just want to, like, be friends with you first, and then we'll be friends. And then after a while, once we're friends, you know, then maybe we'll sit down, we'll have some coffee, and then maybe 2 or 3 months from now, I'll finally share the gospel with you. The only problem with that is that I waited too long, and she got whacked by a bus. Tell me it doesn't happen. We're sitting here waiting for the next big thing that we have to do. Meanwhile, there's people right there, right? He says, wake up, open your eyes, look around. The harvest is there right now. Maybe we just need to look and see who God's already brought into your life, into your circle of influence, and just open your mouth, okay? That's what we need to do. Real simple. There's a chain that can't be broken. You've heard me teach, listen, you're sitting here right now, and you're listening to me teach something, and I'm passing it on to you. I want you to take this, what you're learning, and pass it on to other trustworthy people who will in turn tell others. That's it. This is what Acts chapter 2, this is what Acts chapter 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, all the way to 28, that's what this is about. Open up your mouth and let the gospel come out. Okay? So for all of you that was waiting to talk about tongues, here we are. People have been waiting for years. Here we are. We're in tongues. Okay? I got 3 things I want to talk about tongues. I want to talk about the who gets them. I want to talk about how you get them. And I want to talk about what. But what is divided into 2 things. What is it? And the other thing is, what is it for? Okay? Now listen, I'm going to teach you from a lack of experience. We, when I say that, I don't mean that I'm not qualified. I mean that we cannot let our experience with something dictate what it is. The Bible dictates tongues. It tells us what it is. And if you're not experiencing tongues in the way that the Bible says, then it's not tongues. Okay? Now, this is one of the most heated talks in all of the Bible. In all of Christendom, this is right up there. Tongues. This is what divides churches. This is what keeps people from even walking in our doors here, because everyone's not speaking in tongues. We're not spirit-filled. I'm just saying, this is the experiences that we have here. I would just say that the problem with that is that I don't speak in tongues. He's never given me that gift. But I know that there's people in this room right now that do. Now, again, I don't know what they're saying or why, so I don't know if it's really tongues or not. Like, I'm not the guy to judge that. But I know I don't do it. And so when someone comes in and says, is your church this or that? I can't speak for you, right? Because the church is not me. I just one dude who works here. The church is y'all, right? That's what a church is. So when you do like faith statements on a website, what do you believe? Guess what? Guess what's written down there? What the pastor believes. That's what happens, right? Because we're not, when a church first forms, we don't go around the room and say, okay, what do you believe about the Trinity? Okay, and what do you think about it? And what do you think about it? And we got everyone's, and on the faith page, I list everyone's opinion. Like, nobody does that, right? What do? The pastor who's in charge of that whole thing, he writes down what he believes. And y'all need to agree with him. That's the way a church works, or you don't come. That's the way it is, right? But that's not the way it should be. The church is a group of people that God has called together, Ephesians 4:16, right? Right, to accomplish his purpose. So it's everybody. So this is what I want to do. I want to share with you what the Bible says about tongues, and then you can live out your Christian life according to it. Because it doesn't matter what I think. And I haven't experienced anything. So I'm not going to try to manipulate the text in any way to support what I believe or do, because I don't do it. So everything you're going to hear is just like, hey, this is what this says. Hey, this is what this says. And I want you to adjust your interaction with God according to Scripture, because if we'll do it according to Scripture, that's where the blessing is, right? Not some man-made, conjured-up thing. Let's just do what it says. And I just want to tell you right from the giddy-up, tongues is spooky, right? When you don't do it, it's a little strange. Like when you hear something going on, like, what is this, right? But just, it doesn't matter what I think or feel, and it doesn't matter what anyone thinks or feels. It talks about it in depth in Scripture. Tongues is not explained a lot in the book of Acts. It's done. But we have to look elsewhere for explanation on what it is. Okay, so let's start here. You can keep your finger in Acts 2, but we have to go to 1 Corinthians. Okay, that's the highly concentrated teaching about tongues, other gifts of the Spirit. It's prophecy and healing and all that kind of stuff that everyone thinks is either spooky and I don't want it, or it's everything. So let's talk about who gets tongues. We're just talking about tongues here for a second. Who gets this? Well, it's kind of grouped into a bunch of other gifting here, but we can see what it says. Who gets it? Who gets it? 1 Corinthians 12, verses 8 through 10. Well, not real. Let's just talk 7. A spiritual gift is given to each of us, right? So we can help each other. So we understand, whatever your translation is, basically what's saying here is that we all Christians, everyone he writes to, he's writing to a church, not just everyone in general, just Christians in the church, we all get something from the Holy Spirit, some kind of gifting, some special ability to help each other, like to help the whole church. It's not just about you, okay? If he gives you a gift, whatever it is, it's to be used to benefit all of us. It's to benefit the whole church. So think, if I get the gift of tongues or prophecy or miracles, whatever it is, it's to build the entire church around the world. That's what it's for. It's not just for me to experience something. It's to build Christ's church. Okay, so everybody gets one, it says. To one person, the Spirit gives the ability to give wise advice. To another, the same Spirit gives a message of special knowledge. The same Spirit gives faith to another. And to someone else, the one Spirit gives the gift of healing. Talking about the one Spirit, gives one person the power to perform miracles and another the ability to prophesy. And prophesy is basically just speaking for God, not at, but for. The one Spirit, gives someone else the ability to discern whether a message is from the Spirit of God or from another spirit. Still another person is given the ability to speak in tongues, while another is given the ability to interpret what is being said. Okay, now we'll get to that next verse in a minute. Look at verse 30. Well, no. I think for accuracy and clarity, let's go back to 27. All of you together, that's awesome, are Christ's body. That just goes along with what we're talking about, meeting together, right? Together, all of us together. And each of you is a part of it. We're all needed, all desired, all wanted, all needed, all required. Here are some of the parts that God has appointed. Apostles, prophets, teachers, those who do miracles. Now he's going into the ones that God brought to the church to do these things that he's gifted them to do, right? Do miracles, gift of healing, helping, gifts of leadership, tongues. So he lists some of them, right? And then he says this, he asks these rhetorical questions. Are we all apostles? We talked about that last week. Too many apostles out there, man. Everyone's an apostle. I'm an apostle. I'm a bishop. Call me bishop. Are we all apostles? Are we all prophets? Are we all teachers? Do we all have the power to do miracles? Do we all have the gift of healing? Do we all have the ability to speak in tongues? Do we all have the ability to interpret tongues? Of course not. Of course not. So, who gets tongues? Right. See, there's a lot of people that teach, a lot of denominations that teach, that if you are a legit believer, you're a real Christian, like if you actually get the Holy Spirit to put himself in you, you'll speak in tongues. That's what's taught, right? Have anyone ever been in a church like that? They've heard that? Anybody? Raise their hand. Yeah, I've heard it, right? Okay, but look, but the Bible, right, here we go. Remember, experience, like something may have happened. Maybe there was, listen, if you've been to a youth event for church, like whether they're getting saved, whether the kids get saved or not, they want to get baptized. Just the frenzy going on, right? So I don't understand what's going on in a church when everyone's doing this whole thing with talking this and talking that. But the Bible says that everyone in the church gets a gift, but of course not to all of them getting tongues. It just says it. So I don't want to personally step on toes like myself, but the Bible would say not everybody gets tongues. So to say to be a believer, like that's the evidence, right? If you're a believer, you'll get the Holy Ghost and you'll start speaking in tongues. Now, some people did, right? You saw that. But that doesn't mean everyone does, because the Bible says they don't. And so it just has to end there. It just, boom, it just doesn't happen. Okay. So how do they get it? Well, pretty clear from the text, but look, go back to verse 11 in chapter 12. This is like really clear, to the point. It is the one and only, capital S, Spirit. That's Holy Spirit, right? It is the one and only Holy Spirit who distributes all these gifts. That's where they come from. He alone, that means, just for clarity, no one else gets to decide. He alone decides which gift each person should have. When someone tells you you have the ability, just loose your tongue and let it go. Walk away from them. It's not true. The Holy Spirit decides if you get tongues. We don't go to tongue school. We're not instructed to just let it happen. Right? Use what he's already given. No. You're going to see in the text that the Holy Spirit empowers you and begins to take over, and he does it through you. You can't tell him what to do, and you can't speak tongues on your own. You don't get to choose that. He does. That's what it says. Okay? So just proper teaching. I'm not ripping anybody. But I mean, you just read it right there, right? So like, I'm not some awesome prophet over here giving you go, oh, that's amazing. No, it's right there, right? No gain here. Okay, so who? Not everyone. How? Only Holy Spirit gets to decide. There's no tongue school, no prophecy school. It's you just, God gets to decide, okay? That's what it says. You can't go to school. Wouldn't it be great to go to school to learn how to perform miracles? Like, I could just enroll you. It's $3,500, and I could just teach you how to go to the Waterman and bless the babies. Yes! Yeah. And when I say it, it just sounds so stupid, but yet that stuff's on. I mean, just look on Facebook. You see it all the time. Just, you know, trying to make a buck. Okay, so what is tongues? Go to 1 Corinthians chapter 14. So 12 is talking about like where you get it and that everyone gets it. But then it really starts to talk about like what it is. It's these unknown languages. It's called, in the Greek, it's the word glossa. Okay, glossa. It's a language, one, naturally unacquired. Okay, 14:22, what does it say? So you see that speaking in tongues is a sign not for believers, but for unbelievers. Okay, it's not for believers. It's not to benefit for me. If you're all a believer in here, there's no benefit for you if I speak in tongues. Okay, it says it in the Bible that tongues glossa is it's in the Strong's. It's number 1110 glossa. That's the only one that's there. It's the only one. I looked up this glossolalia that's not even in the Strong's Concordance. I don't know where it comes from. It's garbage. It says glossa. And that's it. And you can test me, and you should. And not that tongues is the most important thing, but I want you to be able to trust what your teacher teaches you. So you should test me. Look. Glossa 1110 in the Strong's. It's glossa. It's an unknown language that is not naturally acquired, and it's a sign for unbelievers, okay? You don't acquire it through, like I said, school. You don't acquire it through through your ethnicity. You don't acquire it through Rosetta Stone or YouTube videos, okay? It's an in-the-moment ability. You see it there in Acts chapter 2. You saw it. The people came from different places, and what happened? These people, all of a sudden, wham, they have the ability to speak your language, all of these countries, all these people, they come, and he's given them the power, the ability. I don't know French, I don't know German, I don't know Italian, I don't know anything, I don't know, all of a sudden, I'm speaking Spanish to the Spanish guy. Woo! Like, that's crazy, right? It's for the unbeliever. It's the people that don't understand the wonderful things that God has done. And so he gives them this incredible ability to tell about the wonderful things that God has done. That's what tongues is. Here's the wonderful thing that God has done. I don't know about you, this blows my brains apart, okay? So you see what's going on here. Like, so Jesus says that these things are going to happen, right? So in Acts chapter 1 and 2, this stuff's going to happen. The Holy Spirit's going to come, and you're going to be messengers and witnesses to the ends of the earth of the wonderful things that God has done. And what does it mean? Okay, so if you go back, in Luke chapter 2, you see the angels appear to the shepherds, and what do they say? I bring you good news that will bring great joy to all people, all nations. Here it is. It's like, whoa, that sounds familiar, right? What is it? The Savior was born, the Messiah, the Lord has been born in the city of David. That's the good news. And all of a sudden, God brings all these people. And the Holy Spirit drops on them, empowered from upon high, so they could be his witnesses to what? To all people, just like it said in Luke 2. This is the good news. This is what God has done. He brought Jesus Christ from heaven descends down, takes on flesh to be with his people and save them. Woo! This is the good news. And so people from all over the world, they're converging upon the disciples in Jerusalem so they can tell them of the good news of the Savior, Jesus Christ. It's amazing how this is happening. And so God has given these disciples this amazing ability to speak the languages of the foreigners that are there in their language. So it's a language. I just don't know it. It's like if someone came in that was just completely like spoke Chinese. And then wham, all of a sudden I'm preaching and I could speak in Chinese to that dude. That'd freak y'all out, wouldn't it? It freaked me out too. So God gives these disciples this incredible Holy Spirit empowered ability to speak known languages, not known to them, but real phonetic languages of these foreigners that were present so they could hear the gospel of Christ, believe in the gospel of Christ, and then go back to their homes with this good news so they too could pass it on to other people. Do you see the ends of the earth starting to happen here? Right out of this room, the ends of the earth are about to be reached. And they don't necessarily even have to go. They just need to open up their mouth to the people that God has brought to their life. And those people will take it to their context and share it with other people. There's more than one way to skin a cat, y'all. And listen, this totally weird, outrageous, incredible, miraculous thing, it happens today. I've never done it. But I know somebody personally that this happened to. He's a kid that I know. Like, he's not a weirdo. He's not a freak. He went on a mission trip to a Spanish-speaking nation, and while he was there teaching, boom, it came out of his mouth. That's crazy. But I know, like, I don't know everybody, and I think some people are way on the fringe is crazy. But when you know someone, you know, love, and trust that dude, like, you know him, it happened. It's for today. It happens today. So, it's a sign for unbelievers, for sure. It's people that don't yet know what God has done through this Jesus Christ. And so we would have the ability to speak their language so they could hear of what God has done. That's tongues. Now, here's where it gets a little bit wonky, okay? There seems to be a little bit of a switch in the text, okay? Again, this is not experience. I'm just going to kind of walk you through this, and you'll see what I'm talking about here. This is not something that I experienced in any way, but not only is it a sign for unbelievers when you speak their language so they could know the gospel, but it's also to strengthen spiritually the one who's actually doing the speaking. So there seems to be a little bit of a switch here in the text about tongues, okay? So look at 14:2. You there in 14:2? So it says, what's that? 1 Corinthians 14:2. For if you have, I'm going to have to just explain some things too. For if you have the ability to speak in tongues, so if God's given you this ability, you'll be talking only to God. No, just wait. Now, follow me here, right? Didn't it just say that the people came with their language and I was able to speak to you in your language? You just saw that, right? So, but what is this saying? So if I'm speaking the tongues, I'm only speaking to God. Well, what would happen there? So I just take that there's some, that's the weird stuff that you hear people saying, right? That stuff that can spook you out, like really, like, whoa, what is that clatter? What is that? I think that's what that is. Like, I'm not saying that everyone who's doing it is legit, but it says, wait a minute, there's this other tongue that's not to a person to share the gospel, But it says here in this tongue, you're only talking to God. And since people won't be able to understand you, right? You'll only be talking to God. Since people won't be able to understand you, you'll be speaking by the power of the Spirit. So you see, you don't get to choose your clatter. That thing that comes out of your mouth, you don't get to choose that. You don't get to choose that at all. He decides it. That's what he puts in your mouth so that you can talk to him. Listen, you'll be speaking by the power of the Spirit, but it will all be mysterious. Like, what's going on here? Like, why am I saying this? It's okay. See, I think a lot of people want to, like, we're talking about tongues, so I want to teach about it, but a lot of us want to, like, really grasp exactly what it is. Like, I get all that, but can we just honor the Scripture? Can we just leave a little room for mystery? Can we just leave it, for lack of a better term, I know it sounds bad, but can't we just leave it a little spooky? Can't we just do that? Isn't it okay to just be like, I don't know, man, it's kind of weird, but, like, I'm talking to God, and the Spirit's making me do this weird sound. Like, that's awesome, right? That's awesome. So he says, you'll be speaking by the power of the Spirit, but one who prophesies, so there's a different thing. So in talking to God, you're talking to the people about God. It strengthens others, encourages them, comforts them. A person who speaks in tongues is strengthened personally. So you see that? That was the claim that I made. So not only is it to tell others in their language about Jesus Christ, tell them the gospel, but at the same time, if you're doing this other thing, because like why would I don't need to share the gospel with Jesus, right? Like he knows it. Right? So if I'm talking to God, I'm not sharing the good news of what God has done so he can get saved. He is saved, right? He's good. So if I'm talking to God, it says that here, if I'm talking to him, not in this other Chinese, Latin, Greek, Hebrew, whatever. But I'm talking to God, and I don't even understand what I'm saying. It's mysterious to me, but somehow in doing this weird clatter, he's using that to strengthen me spiritually. I mean, do you see it there in the text? It just says it. A person who speaks in tongues is strengthened personally, okay? Strengthened personally. Look at verse 14. For if I pray in tongues, my spirit, that's not the Holy Spirit, but my spirit, me, my life in me, the thing that's in me is praying. So I'm praying in tongues. My spirit's praying, but I don't understand what I'm saying. It's a total mystery. If you're really speaking in tongues, like in this other thing, it's almost like you don't really know. Like God's making you do it. And you're being fed from heaven directly, building you spiritually. I mean, it just says that, okay? It just says that. And there's some other people that are godly men and women that would disagree, but I would just say, just look at what it says, okay? Look at verse 15, just keep going. So if I'm praying in tongues, I don't even understand. So the people don't understand what I'm saying. I don't understand what I'm saying. Well, then what should I do? He's like, well, I'll pray in the Spirit, and I'll also pray in words I understand. So I'm going to pray in that Holy Spirit-driven. He's given me these sounds and stuff to say, these utterances. And I'm going to just do that. And then I'm also going to pray in words that I would understand. Right? Because like you, if you want to pour your heart out to God, right, in prayer, would you do that in Chinese? If you wanted to lay out before the Lord these concerns you have about your family members not being saved, would you do it in Greek? What would you do it in? English, right? So we have to understand that when you're speaking to God, you wouldn't be speaking in one of these known languages across the earth. Why would I speak to God in French? I don't understand it, it says. So it would be no good to lay prostrate before the Father and speak in Spanish. I don't even know what I'm saying. I would speak to him in English. So there seems to be this, I think, this other thing. There's this other thing. But now you go to a church. I've been to a church where the pastor, I was crazy, I don't understand this, but he stood up and he told them all, okay, now pray in the Spirit. And all of a sudden, it just went crazy. There was probably 300 people in there. And everybody's doing it, right? Everybody's doing it. So I just want to say, like earlier, I said that there's some churches that say if you're going to be a real Christian, it would manifest itself, you have to speak in tongues. This is an indication of. That's wrong. We read that. I would also say that it's wrong to do that in church too. And I just want you to see what the Bible says, okay? Look at verse 26 of chapter 14. Well, dear brothers and sisters, let's summarize. When you meet together, that's what we're doing right now. One will sing, another will teach. Another will tell some special revelation that God gave them. One will speak in tongues. The other will interpret what is said, but everything should be done to strengthen all of you. No more than two or three should speak in tongues. But what? One at a time, right? Isn't that what we heard? Saw that? And then, so one gets up, and then they would interpret that, so the whole church could be strengthened. Or else, if that can't happen, look what it says. They must speak one at a time. Some must interpret it. But if no one is present who can interpret what that is, they must be silent in your church meeting and speak in tongues to God privately. Shh. None of this full-blown, charismaniac, off-the-charts, frantic, like, what in the world is going on there? That's not biblical. Okay. So we can see clearly that Paul is differentiating between understandable languages and not understandable language. Okay? I understand that there's some type of understandable languages. I just don't know them. Okay, we all can agree with that. But he says that there's a language that is unknown. And I don't think that when you read these verses like we just did, I don't think that it means this, that you would speak to God in German or in Latin or in, you know, Chinese or something. There's no gain there. There's no ability to really speak to him. At Pentecost, you saw that happening where they were speaking in other languages so that people that didn't know Jesus yet could hear the gospel. There's that tongue. But then it seems to be like there's this other tongue, you know? I don't know the meaning of this, but let me just throw this out there. In 13:1, 1 Corinthians 13:1, Paul references, like, if I could speak all the languages of the world, get that, and the language of the angels. I just think that it's, I don't know if that's clearly this, but it just seems to be that maybe there's this other thing, this heavenly thing where you just talk to God alone, just you and him, you commune closely, and somehow through this thing that the Spirit is making you do, that he uses that to strengthen you personally. So there's this other glossa. It's not learned. It's a gift of God, and it's given to a specific person. Not all of us get it, but some of us do, so that they can commune with God in a personal way that spiritually strengthens you and you alone. And 1 Corinthians 14:2 teaches us that the Holy Spirit is giving you the utterance that nobody can understand and that it's mysterious. And that's okay. So I would just say this, loved ones, If you come to a church, if you come to this church, and one day you sit next to someone and you hear something, don't be freaked out. It's mysterious. And that, if now if the Bible said, listen, it shouldn't be doing this and you shouldn't be doing that, should be clear, don't be doing that, then that's one thing, but it doesn't. It says that they should do it privately between them and God, and it's mysterious. So let's let it be mysterious. And let's let people, if they're so gifted, to do this thing that you might think is weird. But if you're like Christ, you consider others above yourself. And if they are communing with God and they're just being blessed from heaven, let them be mysterious. For lack of better terms, can we just allow them to be weird, if that's what you think it is? Just let them and love them through it. It's okay. And because I'll tell you what, you never know. He might drop that on you one day, and you're going to be like, whoa, what's up? Right? I thought that dude was weird, and all of a sudden, ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba, whoa. Right? Just never know. God has a great sense of humor, so be careful. Just saying. So I've never personally experienced either type of tongues myself. Never. But here's what I do know. Only because it says it. Tongues is real. Okay? Tongues is real. Tongues is for today. There's the cessationists that say all this stuff is gone. Then there's the continuationists that says all this stuff is for today. I guess I lean more towards over here, but I don't want to classify myself anything other than a Christ follower. So I'm not going to buy into any camp. I'm not going to sign up for anybody's tribe. I'm on Jesus' team, and that's it. So I believe that it's for today, just as it was at the beginning. And listen, I don't want to just throw that out, right? Why? It should always be biblically supported. Anything that comes off this pulpit should be biblically supported. So do this. Go to 1 Corinthians 13, 8 through 10. All right, you ready? Prophecy, we're not talking about prophecy. We will, later on. But prophecy, speaking for God, and speaking in tongues, and special knowledge. So these are three specific giftings that we saw listed earlier in 1 Corinthians 12, but these are three that he lists. He says, they will become useless, but love will last forever. Okay, so love will last forever. That's good, but in this context, what we're talking about tonight, we're talking about tongues. So it does say that speaking in tongues will become useless. Like there will be a point that is not needed. Okay, so let's just talk for a second here. What are they for? They're a sign for the unbeliever. So if you're from China and you've never heard the gospel, you're an unbeliever, and she drags you to church. Oh, I forget this cool place, you should come. And all of a sudden, I speak in Chinese so that you can get the gospel. Like, that's awesome, right? So that's what, evangelism? We're evangelizing, we're spreading the good news, that's awesome. So there's that tongue. And then there's the other one, if you believe me or not, if you're on my team there with that, it's okay, it's all right. I believe that there's this other one that you do, and it strengthens you, okay? So it's strengthening you. And it's also, the other one is strengthening me, right? So it's strength. So, but both of them are being used to edify and grow the church, right? Numbers and in strength and maturity here, right? So both. And it says those things will become useless. Like they will stop. So there is a time where these things will no longer be valid. He goes on, he says, so the question is, when is that? When is that time? And so some people say, well, that's already come. When the apostles died, that was it. When the Bible was written, so there's one camp that says, when the original apostles, when they died, that was it. They had those gifts, but now we don't. We can have all these other things because they're easy to explain, but the other ones, like, helps. Yeah, we can all help. That's not really supernatural or, But the other ones, like prophecy and tongues, that died with the apostles. So there's that group of people. Then there's another group of people that says that when the Bible came out, we don't need the ability to speak in tongues anymore. What we need to do is just translate the Bible because it's perfect, and we just need to bring those translated Bibles to the tribe out in China in the woods. So there's that group. I'm not part of either one of those groups. I'm part of a different group. Let me tell you what group I'm from. He says here, verse 9, now our knowledge is partial and incomplete, and even the gift of prophecy reveals only part of the whole picture. See, when you go to a church that's a good church, the pastors will teach you well, I hope. I hope you find that here. But no matter how good it is, you ain't never going to know everything. And neither am I. We know that, right? These are obviouses. But look. But when full understanding comes, what does the King James say, Jay? When the perfect arrives? Right. Perfect. Right. So he says we know in part now, but when that which is perfect comes, or full understanding, then these partial things that we do now will become useless. So my position, and you don't have to agree with me, you can make up your own mind. I only know of one perfect entity in the universe. His name is Jesus, and one day he will come. And when he comes to set up his kingdom, like when you're in heaven, one thing you won't need to do is evangelize. Because there won't be anyone there except Christians. So we can see that type of tongue. I don't need to preach in Chinese anymore. Do you agree? In heaven? The other thing I don't need to do is I don't need to speak in some heavenly language to this God up there when I'm looking at him in my face. Because it says that we'll see him. We see in a cloud of mirror, but soon we'll see face to face. Doesn't that what it says in the old King James? Face to face. Listen, so tongues is for today and only will cease when we are in the presence of Jesus Christ. So that we need to be able to have that supernatural deposit to evangelize to the ends of the earth still, because he hadn't come back yet, so we got a job to do. And we also need to be built up on our own. We can't just spend all our days preaching to other people. We need a little bit of this. Isn't that why you came tonight? So we need some of that too. And when Jesus comes, then and only then has the perfect arrived. And these things will be unnecessary. Here's the other thing too. We're about done. Tongues. Man, I'm so tired of tongues being the most important thing in a church. I am so over it. Like, if it's in the Bible, then it's important. Can we agree? Yeah. It's fine. It's awesome. And we should. We should want it. We should want to see it. You shouldn't come to church and think that guy's weird. You should want people next to you doing it. You should want to do it yourself. But I'm just so tired of it being people won't come to this church because I don't speak in tongues and it's not going crazy in the church. And we've had people leave this church that came in. Oh, I love this place, man. You're a great dude. I love all these people. I love the way it's set up. I love when you meet. I love all this stuff. And then, but I don't hear you speaking in tongues. And they've left. Like, really? Tongues is covered, for the most part, really, mentioned here and there, but very lightly. But other than that, it's covered in 1 Corinthians 12 and 1 Corinthians 13 and 14. Three chapters in the entire Bible. I mean, that's extensive if you think about it. That's a lot. I mean, if you read those three chapters, there's a lot about that in tongues in those three chapters. But listen, loved ones, there's 1,189 chapters in the Bible. Verses 3. So how important is it? Just look at the time spent by Almighty God to present it to his people. 1,189 chapters, three of them cover tongues. So let's view tongues biblically, right? It's not the most important thing at all. Paul prioritizes it in, I shouldn't have closed my Bible, 1 Corinthians chapter 14, verses 18 and 19. Well, let's go 1 Corinthians 14. Let's do 5 and 6 first. Hold on, 5 and 6. What's it say? I wish you could all speak in tongues. Remember I said it would be great if everyone in the church, you could hear them all doing it? Like quietly, but you could hear. Because when you do it quietly, I know people that do it quietly. They don't do it quietly. You can just kind of hear it a little bit. But that's respectful. And he says here, Paul says, I wish you could all do that. So we should want that. We should welcome it. If we should welcome it for ourselves, we should be thrilled when other people are doing it. Don't think it's weird. Don't check out when they do it. No, it's okay because the Bible says that God's writing this through Paul. God wishes that all of us could speak in tongues. But even more than that, I wish you could all prophesy. See, I wish you could all speak to me, but more importantly, I'd like for you all to speak to people for me. For prophecy is greater than speaking in tongues. You see it right there, right? Why? Because unless someone interprets what you're saying, the whole church won't get it. So what good is it? See, all these gifts are for the building up of the church, of everybody. So that's why he's like, I wish you could all just prophesy, like learn what I say here and tell people about that, rather than you just sitting there going, this is good, but this is better. This is better. Look at verses 18 and 19. Paul's like, not only do I want everybody to speak in tongues, but watch this. I thank God that I speak in tongues more than any of you. He's a little arrogant. But in a church meeting, you know, when the whole church is trying to get edified and built up and we're spreading it to the ends of the earth and we're gaining more people and I'd rather speak 5 understandable words to help others than 10,000 on my own. You could sit there all day and do this thing that you got, and it's good. He says, I want you to. That's good. But more importantly than 10,000, like I don't even know how long it would take to speak 10,000 words. I don't know. That's a long time, right? Let's just say an hour, 2 hours. I don't even know. I don't even know how many words are in a sermon. I don't know. But he's like, I'd rather you just speak 5 understandable. I'd rather have you just say Jesus Christ and him crucified. That's it. Than for me to sit here and just do for an hour and a half by myself. So prioritizing tongues is important, okay? So let's put this mysterious, highly debated topic in its proper place, okay? God gifts people this gift to advance his mission of building his kingdom. Okay, that's why tongues exist. So with kingdom building as our ultimate and singular goal, Paul says in 1 Corinthians 14, 12, and this is where we end, he says this, since you are so eager to have the special abilities, these gifts that the Spirit gives, seek those that will strengthen the whole church. Okay? In other words, seek the gifts that will help these folks that God's called you to together to grow deeper with Him. And seek giftings that will help the population of His kingdom grow. The growing population is a king's glory. That's what we shared last week. He wants more people to worship him, and then he wants us, all of us, to get deeper and more intimate with him. So, I don't know if you'll do this with me or not, but I'm just going to ask you to do this. He says, seek these things. Seek the gifts that'll build up the church. And so how would we do that? Well, first we'd have to make a decision in our heart and our mind that I'm not going to let the spookiness of it affect my desire to want it. Like, it's okay to be mysterious. And if you're okay with it being mysterious and you want to be part of his team to build his church and reach the ends of the earth, then why don't we take a few moments and why don't we pray? He decides who gets the gifts. But he says, you have not because you ask not. And so maybe if you'd ask him for the gift of tongues, maybe if you asked him for the gift of prophecy, maybe if you asked him for the gift of healing, maybe if you asked him for the gift to do miracles, maybe if you asked him for the gift of helping others, who knows? Perhaps God would give you that gift. So let's ask him. Lord God, we are humbly standing before you, knowing that it is the one Spirit alone who decides what gift we get. We understand, Lord, that we can't fabricate, we can't conjure up, we can't fake it. For if we do, you know the difference, and it's nothing. There's no power there, Lord. But our heart is to see your kingdom advance. That's why we came here tonight. And so, God, we would ask that your Spirit that dwells in us would be so gracious, so kind, so generous, as to deposit within us gifts. Perhaps tongues, perhaps prophecy. Perhaps we could lay our hands on the sick and they would be healed. Whatever gifts that you would decide that we could steward well and use for your glory, we would ask you, Lord, maybe open your hands, loved ones, to just deposit them in us now. God, I've tried my very best to follow your lead. I've tried my very best to teach what your word says. I pray, Holy Spirit of God, that you would lead your loved ones into all truth. And let them learn what you desire for them to learn from this tonight. Nothing more, nothing less. Lord, I also pray now as we continue our worship, before we sing to you. Oh, it's going to be so great. But before we sing to you, Lord, we'd like to respond to your generosity with our own. You showed your great love by sending your Son. Your love is always expressed in something visible and tangible. And we'd like to show our great love to you. We'd like to show our great love to those who don't yet know what we know by giving generously to advance your kingdom through this church that you've called us to. We're all here. We all heard. We've all been gifted in some way. Help us now to know how to give. Loved ones, just take a few moments and pray personally, just personally.